ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। We are reading today from Srimad Bhagavatam, canto number 10, chapter number 21, text number 12. Please repeat after me. Krishnam Niriksha Vanitosva Rupashilam Shrutva Cha Tat Kvanita Venu Vivikta Gitam Devoyo Vimana Kataya Smara Nuna Sara Brasyat Prasunna Kabara Mumuhur Vinivaya Krishna Nirikshaya Vinitsa Rupa Shilam Shutvacha Tat Kavanita Venu Vivikta Gitam Devyo Vimana Gatya Svara Nunusara Prasyat Prasunna Kabara Mumur Vivana Krishna Nirikshaya Vinitva Rupa Shilam Shutvacha Tatva Kvarnita Venu Vivikta Gitam Devyo Vimana Gat Smaram Nunu Sara Brasyat Prasunna Kabara Mumuhur Vinivaya Krishna Ladies, Krishna Nikesha Vinita Sarupashya. Devo Mana Gatasvarasara. Prasyat suno Krishna, Lord Krishna, Nirikshaya, observing Vanita for all women, Utsava, a festival, Rupa, whose beauty, Shilam, and character, Shrutva, hearing, cha, and tat, by him, Kvanita, vibrated, Venu, of the flute, Vivikta, clear, Gitam, song, Devya, the wives of the demigods, Vimana Gataya, traveling in the airplanes, Smara, by Cupid, Nuna, agitated saraha, their hearts, rasya, slipping, prasunna kabaraha, the flowers tied in their hair, mumuhu, they became bewildered, vinivyaha, their belts loosening. Translation by the servants of A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Krishna's beauty and character create a festival for all women. Indeed, when the demigods' wives, flying in airplanes with their husbands, catch sight of him and hear his resonant flute song, their hearts are shaken by Cupid, and they become so bewildered that the flowers fall out of their hair and the belts loosen. Purport. In Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Srila Prabhupada comments, this verse indicates that the transcendental sound of the flute of Krishna extended to all corners of the universe. Also, it is significant that the gopis knew about the different kinds of airplanes flying in the sky. In fact, even while sitting on the laps of the demigod husbands, the demigoddesses became agitated by hearing the sounds of Krishna's flute. Thus, the gopis thought that they themselves should not be blamed for their ecstatical conjugal attraction for Krishna, who, after all, was a cowherd boy from their own village and thus a natural object of their love. If even demigoddesses became mad after Krishna, how could poor earthly cowherd girls from Krishna's own village avoid having their hearts completely conquered by his loving glances and the sounds of his flute? The gopis also considered that the demigods, although noting their wives' attraction to Krishna, did not become envious. The demigods are actually very refined and cultured and intelligence, and therefore, when flying in the aeroplanes, they regularly take their wives along to see Krishna. The gopis thought, our husbands, on the other hand, are envious. Therefore, even the inferior deer are better off than we, and the demigoddesses are also very fortunate, whereas we poor human beings in an immediate position are most unfortunate. Om Ajnanti Mirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Nama Shri Chaitanya Mano Vishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavansham Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha. He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhano Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhya Evacha Patita Nam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnave Bhyo Namo Namaha.
भज श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद जय अद्वैत गदाधर शिव सादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
सो श्रीमद् भागवतम दिस चैप्टर इज एंटाइटल्ड द गोपीज ग्लोरिफाई कृष्णस फ्लूट चैप्टर नंबर 21 द श्लोक अगेन कृष्णस ब्यूटी एंड कैरेक्टर क्रिएट अ फेस्टिवल फॉर ऑल वेमेन Indeed, when the demigod's wives flying in the airplanes with their husbands catch sight of him and hear his resonant flute song, their hearts are shaken by Cupid and they become so bewildered that the flowers fall out of their hair and the belts loosen. We have taken, I was told the other day, nearly 30 years, every day reading one shloka. To come up to this level. Actually, this level is not meant for the ordinary people. This is meant for very highly qualified devotees. Even Vedvyasji, who is none other than the incarnation, literal incarnation of Lord Krishna, Shaktavesh Avatar, he had written and split the four Vedas. Into four. He had written the Puranas, Upanishads, and yet, after writing the Mahabharata, particularly Bhagavad Gita is right in the middle of the Mahabharata, he was feeling unhappy and despondent. Why was he feeling this despondency? Because up to that stage, he, as Saktavesh Avatar, just imagine, was conscious of Krishna. We all know Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, full of infinite six opulences. And consciousness is a symptom of the soul. We all know this. The soul has only one property, just like the sun has the property of giving heat and giving us light. Similarly, the soul has the property of giving consciousness. And we are all soul, we are not the body. And this consciousness, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, flows through the blood throughout the body. Where there is no blood, there is no consciousness. Like in the hair, go to the barber, it gets cut, there's no feeling. So, up to that stage, Vedvyasji had reached and he was so unhappy. He was all alone. But his Guru Maharaj knew, Narad Muni, and he came to his kutir in Uttarakashi, right beyond Badrinath. And he asked Vedvyas, why are you so unhappy? He said, I have written so much, lakhs and lakhs of shlokas, but I somehow don't feel completely in bliss. He said, because you have not written about bliss. Simple. Supposing you want money, where do you go? You go to the bank, isn't it? Where there is tons of money, if you have an account there. So, just like you have to be introduced in the bank to open the bank account. Similarly, you have to be introduced to the bliss portion of Sat, Chit, Anand. Up to Sat and Chit, you can get in any shop. Down the corner, Bharatiya Bhavan, you can get Bhagavad Gita. It will take you on Sat, Truth, Chit, Knowledge. That is what most people think is the end, final, but that's not so. Vedvyas says, I have not experienced bliss. Why? So Narad Muni said, because you have not written about bliss, the personification of bliss, Lord Krishna. You have to write about his birth. You have yourself written. Narad Muni tells Vedvyas. What is it? 4.9? Srimad Bhagavad Gita. Janma karma cha me divyam evam yo viti tatvata tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti maam eti so Arjuna. You have written about that if you understand in tattva, in a sense, the birth of Lord Krishna, it's a divine birth, not like ours, and the divine activities of Lord Krishna, then you will go home back to Godhead. But up to now, you have not written about the divine birth and divine activities. So why don't you do that? So that you can fully benefit from your human life. Otherwise, there is no difference between human life and dogs. I was seeing on TV, somebody sent me on internet about a parrot. And the parrot was actually having Sat and Chit also. I was surprised. Everything practically he knew. Within seconds, somebody would ask and he would say the answer. Parrot-like. I remembered Shukha Goswami the moment I saw that parrot. But there's a difference. Sukhdev Goswami had bliss also, Krishna. So what this chapter onwards will give you, of course there is the birth of Lord Krishna, appearance of Lord Krishna earlier, but now we are getting into what we would call in swimming language, deep waters. We are now getting into the ocean of bliss. Anybody wants to get out, that's the door there. But believe me, after this, you are entitled to get bliss. Alright, we are all ready? Haribol. So in the Nectar of Devotion, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, page 193. There is one quality of Krishna, the last final quality, which he doesn't share with anyone. But fortunately for us, Prabhupada has brought us that 64th quality to us in the book form, in his book form. What is that 64th quality? Anybody remember? Madhurya, his beauty and his activities. The attractiveness of Krishna, Prabhupada writes, the attractive of Krishna is in his body and sound. This is very important. The attractive, Krishna is all attractive. Akrishna iti Krishna. Definition of Krishna. Rama iti Ramaha. He is all blissful, giving us the joy. Rama. But Krishna is all attractive. Akrishna, Akrishan, one who attracts like magnet. Akrishna iti Krishna. How does he attract us? By his beauty and his sound. Now, how does his sound come to us? Or how did it go to the gopis? It came through the Venu. Okay. Even if he was miles away, the sound of his Venu was able to be spread. The vibration of the sound is not like this sound of this mic or my voice, which cannot be heard even in the other building. But it was millions of miles away. The demigoddesses could hear. And she got attracted. So that is the sound of Krishna. Of course, when we chant the holy name of the Lord, that is also sound. But that benefits us only. It doesn't benefit everyone. But the Venu benefits everyone. So, now this morning class will be on Venu Gita. This title of this chapter is given by Jiva Goswami. And therefore I will rely on Jiva Goswami's wonderful book called Gopala Champu. This is his book, available downstairs. What happened is, in practical terms, what happens to all of us who have got children, especially girls, daughters. What happens when the daughter grows up? You know, the mother tells the father first, "Arey, thoda bichar to karo. Apni ladki badi hone lagi, shaadi wali hogi. She'll become fit for getting married. Please think of our daughter. You're only thinking of your business." And that happened in Vrajbhumi also. So, according to our Jiva Goswami, who is a great authority, these ladies, the senior gopis, they told their husbands that you are doing your household duties very beautifully and other businesses of yours. But now our daughters are growing up. We have to find suitable husband. And what did the daughters want? Which husband? Krishna. The mothers knew it, but the fathers didn't know. So the fathers were looking here and there, as usual. And they thought that boy is very good, that boy is very good, so and so's son is very good. And the daughters were feeling, oh my God, my father just doesn't understand me. There's nothing new. At that time, teenagers were in the same mood. So what happened was, they went to Purnamasi. Who's Purnamasi? She's a very senior lady. She's actually Yogmaya. Okay? Yogmaya is the internal strength, potency of Krishna. And Purnamasi was consulted. And she said, now this is very important. And she, what she did do is more important. Purnamasi made arrangement so that the girls had no intimate contact with their husbands. She made duplicate gopis. The gopis who had intimate relation with the so-called quote-unquote husbands which were fixed by the father were different, and thus preventing intolerable mental agony. Though they were taken to the houses on the path, she concealed them by their illusory powers and provided substitute forms of gopi. So, now we have the truth. Lalita, Vishakha, whom we see on right here, next to Krishna and Radharani, they had husbands. Even Radharani had husband. Radharani's husband was none other than the shadow of Krishna. Okay, Abhimanyu was the shadow of Krishna. He got a form. It's not unusual. For instance, even the shadow of Vivishvan's wife, Vivishvan, you know, is the sun god. His wife, wife's name is Samajya, that is Usha. She also has a shadow. And Usha's shadow is called Chaya. Chaya. Chaya is a lady actually. And can you believe it? She also delivered children. Just as Usha's daughter is Yamuna, right? And Yamuna's twin brother is Yamraj. And there's one more, Manu. And the other side, Chaya, the shadow, got Shani. Shani, you know, we say Shani Dasha. So Shani is the son of actually Surya, through the Chaya. So similarly, Krishna's own shadow became the husband of this one, Radharani. And similarly for Vishakha Lalita. Is it clear now? So no worry, huh? They had Krishna as their husband. But their duplicate gopis were married to the local gopas. When Purnamasi went to the girls in the houses, she told them to be patient. If you think your limit has been reached, then escape. So the original instruction to escape when Krishna plays his flute was given by Purnamasi. Now it's clear? This idea or the thought was given by none other than Yogmaya herself to the original gopis. I will arrange this by my inconceivable power. Who says this? Purnamasi. I will make a place where you can flee. That is why when Krishna plays his flute, the gopis leave their homes. Because they have confidence, faith in Purnamasi. Who's Yogmaya? Yogmaya has made arrangements. Going from their father's houses, which were like the king's prison, they went to the enemy's prison and remained there. That's very interesting. Prabhupada often tells us that this world is like a prison, isn't it? Durga. Durga means fortress. So, these girls would go out of their father's home, which were like king's prison, or their husband's homes. But they were searching for Krishna. Till they found Krishna, they thought they are in prison. And the moment you find Krishna, you are liberated. That is the point. True liberation comes only when we achieve Krishna consciousness. Till then we are not truly liberated eternally. We may be temporarily given a pass. Acha, you are a good man. You are given parole. They are sent out from prison, you know, temporarily. 7 din maza karke aajao. Nahi aayega to police pakad ke wapis le aayega. You see, police will get you back. So these gopis wanted eternal bliss. Because they were very, very, very intelligent. The gopis knew exactly what they wanted. And this is what we shall want. We must become fully Krishna conscious. In this lifetime itself. Because you never know, Prabhupada says, what will happen in your next life. It all depends on what was your last thought. It all depends on various actions and activities you have done. So if you have done activities of Krishna consciousness now, that's an additional positive factor. If you think of Krishna and chant his holy name, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. At the end of your life, you are bound to go home back to Godhead. What happens there? We shall shortly come into details. When the desire for Krishna rose in their minds, they hid it under their consideration of dharma. Like fire is hidden by damp wood. You know, when wood is wet, you can't see the fire inside. Even if you put it in a fire, it won't burn. Isn't it? So what the gopis were like, they had a fire inside. They had strong Krishna consciousness inside. But externally, they showed that they had no Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada often says that we should be like a lady who has a paramour. Paramour means a secret lover. But in the house, she will cook very well. She will take care of the house, take care of the children, husband, everything. But her mind is attached to her supreme lover, Krishna, in this case. So here we are that Jiva Goswami explains to us several things. First thing is, the gopis depended only on Purnamasi to guide them, Yogmaya. The gopis had no other husband but Krishna. Purnamasi provided them duplicate, same form, who married the men who the father had chosen. It was Purnamasi who instigated them that you escape from your house when you hear the Venu. Okay, now the sequence is very clear. All this we can know only because of Prabhupada's mercy. The reason is this parampara, Gaudiya Sampradaya, is the only one I know of, because I have read books of all the 4 Sampradayas, of course before that Mayavadis. They come nowhere near this, because they don't know also. And because of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu having come in our Sampradaya, he is the one, he is Krishna, so he knows everything. In the mood of Radharani, so he has that mellow, that wonderful rasa. Right now many of you are tasting mangoes, king of the fruits. So you know what is rasa. It's a very beautiful taste of the mango. Similarly, just imagine
Krishna is totally covered by rasa. And that rasa is yellow cover. And therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's color is golden complexion. And always he is meditating on Krishna as Radharani would. So now we go further. This Venu, it's written Venu Geet. Venu, there are actually, I must tell you if you all want to know, I have got with me, I prepared notes, long, long back. Something very interesting. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He has a Venu which is 6 inches long because he was at that time. And that Venu has got one big hole in the front and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 holes towards the other side. Later on, he has another one called Murli. Murli is 15 inches long. It has one hole in the front where he puts his lotus lips. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 holes. More than Murli, he has got what is called Vamsi. And this Vamsi is 18 inches long, but surprisingly, it has only 4 holes. He also has a larger Vamsi, which is called Mahananda, also known as Sun Mohini. And Sun Mohini is made of jewels. When it is still larger, it is known as Aksharini. And even when it is longer and bigger than Aksharini, the final is Anandini. So these are the various flutes. The English language is nothing. It has only one word, flute. But if you really want to get it into the depth of things and study like a PhD thesis, you have to learn Sanskrit. And in Sanskrit, there is starting Venu, next Murli, then Vamsi, then we go beyond Vamsi, we go to Mahananda, we go to Sanamohini, then we go to Aksharini and Anandini. And then you should know that there are three. One is made of bamboo, Venu. One is made of gold. And third made of gold plus jewels. So the gopis are all jealous. We are sometimes jealous, no? Envious, jealous. Somebody has done something. Somebody has got something. In this world, everything is a perverted reflection of the spiritual world. Everything. So if there is jealousy here, then there is bound to be something there also. Otherwise, how jealousy came here? Correct? If there is a reflection, then unless there is an original, where is the case of a reflection? Here is the case where the authorities, such as Jiva Goswami and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, who wrote this beautiful book, Saratha Darshini. In that they explain that the gopis were jealous of Venu. Why? Because the Venu is always at the lips of Krishna. My God, what a position to have. I wish I was in that position. And what has this Venu done to deserve to be always at the lips of Lord Krishna? After all, her father is a bamboo. The mother is the river, water. So, where is the question? And besides, this Venu is a material thing. Not even a human being. And how this Venu has got such a position of being always at the lips of Lord Krishna. So, what work has she done? How is it that this beautiful sound comes out of her? So our Bhagavatam says, Barha Pidam Natara Vapahu Varnayo Karnakaram Bibradvasaha Kanaka Kapisham Vaijayantim Jamalam Randar Venur Adara Sudraya Gopavrandai Ravindam Swadapa Ramanam pravrishad gitahi kirtahi. This Venu, because of Krishna's lips touching the Venu becomes a devotee. Okay? By Krishna's touch, by seeing Krishna, by tasting Krishna's prasad, by hearing Krishna katha, or by listening to Krishna's flute, we are talking about Venu, you can become Krishna conscious. It's somewhat like, I was hearing this morning, it's wonderful. I was praying to Prabhupada this morning that I have to give class and I'm not fully prepared yet because I had other things to do. And there it was, early morning class. Prabhupada says, if you are on a big ship made of metal and somebody touches that metal with electricity, power, what would happen? The whole ship will become electrified, isn't it? And therefore it's very dangerous. Similarly, if you are on the platform of Krishna consciousness, you are on the platform of Krishna consciousness, is a Venu, even non-living entity is on the platform of Krishna consciousness, it becomes Krishna conscious. It's like touching a live electric wire. You will get the shock, whether you like it or not. The same voltage will go through you. I'm an electrical engineer, I have had many shocks. Because when we experiment with machinery and all that, you know, in the lab, we get these shocks. We know how to attend to it too, so that we don't die. Hare Krishna?
So you give shock also.
I give shock also. He has had shocks from me. Hare Krishna. When did you come from London? Abhi hai. Achcha, achcha. Hari bol. So, we are now on the subject of what happens to this Venu. And we are on Venu Geet. So this beautiful chapter is here that two things happen when we hear this Venu Geet. Right now we are not hearing Venu. We are not hearing Krishna's Venu. But we are hearing about Krishna's Venu. Correct? It's somewhat like, it's not the same thing, but it's somewhat like if there is a person who is talking about a beautiful book. Srimad Bhagavatam is most beautiful. And you just close your eyes and you just think, if the speaker is so good that he carries you away into that lila of Krishna. All your miseries, because all of us in this world, Prabhupada says, are bound to have huge amount of miseries. In fact, it starts with birth. Birth, death, old age and disease. These four are miseries. And what are they caused by? Adi Devik, Adi Bhautik, Adhyatmik, Trivida Tapa. These miseries are caused by whom? Who? Adi Devik. Right now we have in such a wonderful place like Kedarnath, the river has overflowed. Thousands and thousands of people are suffering over there. And all mud and sludge and everything has gone everywhere. It happens. Adi Devik. Earthquake, tsunami, so many things. In America, in a place called Oklahoma, there was a tornado. Finish, whole city is smashed. So you can have like that problem. Then, worse than that actually, is Adi Bhautik. You think that person is your friend. You think that person will do something good for you. I am doing already so many things for him. He will give you a kick in your pants. He will stab you in the back. So many times it has happened. The history is full of it. Right from days of Satyug onwards. People will not be what you expect. They will do just the opposite. And this is the material world. We must accept that this is going to happen. But there is a remedy for it. Just as you have a disease. Disease has a remedy. For instance, if you've got typhoid, then I don't know how many doctors are here. Tetramycin, what is it to be? I'm an engineer. But tetramycin, something like that is taken, isn't it? It's one of the mycins anyway. It's not my sin, nah, it's your sin. So, I don't know how they gave the name mycin. But anyway, it's in English. These are doctors, you know, pharmaceutical. Yeah, if an engineer was there, he would have studied carefully every word. And given the right name. So the point here is that these diseases have a solution. Now for instance, some bad fellow has built something and he says, no, you can't do this. It happened in China because I have now got some Chinese connection. So beautiful highway was built, okay, and from both sides. 400 kilometers, 200 this side, 200 this side. But in the middle of that road, there was a house of an old farmer. And that farmer just refused to budge. But that is a China where there is no freedom. In the Singapore Prime Minister told our Prime Minister in India that this country of yours, there is one big problem. You have too much freedom. Everybody thinks he can go to court. That's why we have millions of cases here. Lawyers here? Some lawyers will know how many crores cases are lying in the court. So this is how it is. This, we must accept the world, but there is a solution to it. If you approach the same person, you approach the same thing, who's causing you all the trouble, causing you misery after misery, big time big misery, and you take a humble position, and you say, alright, you tell me the solution. This is my problem. This is, you have no problem, but I have a bigger problem. Now you please tell me how to solve this problem. If you take this humble position, you will get a solution. Who says this? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Tranadapi sunichena, tarorapi saishunam, amani namanadena, kirtanya sadahari. Become humbler than the blade of grass. Be more tolerant than a tree. This is exactly what happened to Venu. This Venu was more humble than a blade of grass and more tolerant than her father, the tree. Why? Because if you know, when there's a big wind, these things, grass bends only like that. But if the tree is very strong, you know, and he wants to be upright all the time, it'll be killed, knocked down. But the grass, when the wind blows over it very strongly at 200 kilometers per hour, it'll bend. And when the wind has gone, it'll again rise. Correct? So that is called humbleness. Temporarily at least, one should be humble. You cannot be eternally. Samajh jana chahiye. This is not our time. When our time comes, we'll come up. So, what Venu is doing is that. And when Krishna himself has put his nectar, is very important. Because these gopis were jealous of Venu, therefore, what Krishna says is, don't be jealous, please. I'll give you benefit of this, but it'll come through the agency of Venu. Just like you have to buy a ticket, no, sometimes, bus ticket, train ticket, whatever. You go to an agent, travel agent. So, that travel agent is not what you want. What you want is a train ticket to get in the train or the bus or aeroplane. So similarly, the Venu is the agency. Okay. And therefore, you have to listen to the agent. Correct? And therefore, you are listening to the Venu Gita. Now what does the Venu Gita talk about? That is very important. Just like any other song of God, Krishna, there are three things he is telling through the Venu Gita. This is very important. Firstly, most important is we have to surrender to Krishna. Because every moment of our life, you may know or not know, you are surrendering to something. Whether you like it or not. Many people have thought that we are not surrendering to anything. But death is certain. Whether you like it or not. Whether you are a very rich multi-billionaire or you are a poor man on the street. It's the same quality. Death is the same. There's no difference. It's a leveler, as they say, universal leveler. So, the first thing about Venu is, she says, I was actually happy with my parents. I was happy in the river Yamuna, right, with my mother. But I was cut and made into a flute. But now I am very happy because I am at the lips of Krishna. And Krishna is keeping me tucked in his clothes when he is not playing the flute. So I'm always close to Krishna. So this is what is important. First lesson of Enugit. Always, always, always be close to Krishna. Never leave Krishna. How do you become close to Krishna? By being with the associates of Krishna. Which are the associates of Krishna? First and most powerful associate of Krishna is Srila Prabhupada. He is Saktavesh Avatar for giving this whole world, fulfilling Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's desire. Do you know the difference between love? Again, English is not good enough. Between prem and pyar in Hindi. Pyar is we love for our own senses benefit and enjoyment. And prem is when you want to only give benefit and happiness and bliss to the object of your love. Okay. So, Venu is doing that. She is giving the love to Krishna and Krishna's associates, the gopis. It's not only gopis, even the animals. Now we are coming to that. Which was the first animal which became Krishna conscious? By exactly the cows. The cows were the first ones who picked up their ears. The first animals, or amongst animals and birds. They were the first ones to listen to the Gita, Venu Git, and they were the first to immediately react. And they came towards Krishna to lick him. Okay. That is why, because Krishna, what is that? O Brahmana, Githayata, Krishna Govindaya, Namo Nama. What is before Brahmana? Go Namo Brahmanya Devaya. Go Brahmana Itaya. Jagatyataya Krishnaya Govindaya Namo Nama. So that is why the cow is mentioned. Because you can make out if there is a class. You are in a classroom. And one boy or a girl for that matter, before the teacher even finishes the sentence, he has caught the point. And he has understood fully. He is the sharpest of the lot. In that sense, the cow is the sharpest of the lot. That is why go Brahmana Itayacha. Go is first and not Brahman. Many Brahmins think we are bigger. We should have been Brahmana Go Itayacha. No, it's Go Brahmana Itayacha. Because of this reason, that the cow reacted first before even the Brahmins did. Second thing, why did Krishna play the flute in the first place? Because the gopis, some of them were so miserable, that they wanted to almost commit suicide. They were so unhappy with their husbands, with their mother-in-laws. You know the various stories of Radharani and Kutila. What was that other one? Kutila and? Jatila. Yes. There are so many. Our Bhakti Charu Maharaj spoke about one beautiful story from here only. How Krishna fooled both of them. How saved Radharani from the miseries of mother-in-law and sister-in-law. But just imagine if Radharani has to suffer mother-in-law and sister-in-law. Then what of this world? So you ladies all please be satisfied. Don't ever worry about mother-in-laws and sister-in-laws, because Radharani had that problem. Our mother-in-law is not as bad. Okay? Or sister-in-law. Don't even think about them. Because then that moment of thought is wasted. You have to think of Krishna only. Man manava mad bhakta. He never says, mother-in-law man manava. He never says that. Don't even think of it. Because that's a waste of time. And why? Krishna says, time I am. If Krishna is time, then why you want to waste time? That means you are wasting Krishna. Correct? So you have to think of not wasting time. Because time is limited. The number of breaths we have is the determination of our life. So if you waste our breath, That's one breath gone. But if you do it with chanting the holy name, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. That is the best use of time and breath. And that will take you home back to Godhead. I'm coming now to the very great gentleman called Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. He says, the gopis might have criticized the flute for having holes in it. The gopis said, ye kya flute hai? There are holes in the flute. Just like, you know, when you see some very beautiful lady dressed very beautifully, then some woman who's jealous will find some little flaw in that dress or something. She says, kuch nahi hai. She's got some hole in her sari. You see? But then Krishna realized, because Krishna is in everyone's heart also, Paramatma. So what he did? Krishna filled the holes with the nectar of his lips. Okay. So actually in the flute, there are no holes. The holes are already filled with nectar from his lips. Though the flute is non-living, the touch of the nectar of Krishna's lips brought it to life and empowered it to madden the three worlds. That is how the demigoddesses heard and they got maddened. That is the shloka we did today morning, this shloka. That the demigoddesses got affected by the flute because of Krishna's lips. Every part of Krishna is Krishna's. There is no difference between Krishna's lips, Krishna's eyes, Krishna's lotus feet. They are all absolute. Who says this? Bhakti Siddhanta Maharaj. Beautifully explained in Brahma Samhita. So he says that any part of Krishna, even disconnected to Krishna, like his holy name is available to us in this world, is the same. Of course, this reminds me of that, there was a challenge one day that who is more important, Ram or Ram's name? Have you heard this story, all of you? Everybody knows? No? So one day, what happened was, this is now we are getting into Ramayana for a few minutes. This Ramchandraji himself, personally, I mean this is Ram Leela, was wondering, how is it that these huge big boulders and stones from mountains, Hanuman and company, it's a company's name, and the shareholders and workers are all monkeys. So they are cutting these big, big stones and throwing in the ocean. I've been there, many of you have been there, no? Dhanush Koti, and there's a, what the British gave the name, Adam's apple, I don't know how they got that. But anyway, there's neither Adam nor there's an apple. But there's a bridge. And all these stones were floating actually. So how is it that this is floating? Who? Ramchandra is thinking. Stone, I made the stones, and stones are supposed to sink in water. So how is it that these stones are floating? He was thinking for a moment. Then one afternoon, when everybody was having their lunchtime, 1 to 2, all the monkeys on the trees eating fruits and so on, Ramchandraji quietly went and picked up a stone and threw it in the ocean. And what happened? It sank. He looked around. Kisi ne dekha to nahi na? Everybody's stone is floating and my stone has sunk. Hanuman is always there. Ever ready, Hanumanji is there only. He is always at the seva of Ram. So Ram looked at him. He was a little ashamed, but anyway. He said, Hanuman, did you see what happened? Haji, Prabhuji, I saw. But my stone sank. And you are throwing much bigger stones and how they are floating. So Hanuman said, shall I tell you? You won't feel bad? No, I won't feel bad. Tell me the truth. Says, because we write the name Ram on each stone, that is why the stone floats. You didn't write your name, so it sank. Those who take the name of Ram will always float. Even a dead object like a stone. What to talk of Venu? Okay. So this is the connection. The connection is by taking the holy name of the Lord, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Our soul at the time of departure from this body will float on the prana, go out of this body, will sit on our mind, which will be Krishnaized by that time. It will go in the direction, because our intelligence has already become Krishnaized, and it will go home back to Godhead. Because the mind becomes the vehicle of the soul after death. Provided we chant our 16 rounds for 55 and a half years non-stop. This is the calculation. So please chant. Okay. And Ram's name is also there. Balram bolo, Ram bolo ekhi hai. As far as Prabhupada once explained. Two of his sannyasis were fighting. Can you imagine? Prabhupada sannyasi in Hyderabad. So one sannyasi says, it is strictly written there, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. The other fellow is saying that Ram is actually Balram. So they both fighting went to Prabhupada. Because after all, Prabhupada is the guru of both. So is he right or he is right? So Prabhupada became very sort of serious. Then he looked at both of them and he said, both of you are right. Now how can you be both right? They themselves said, but Prabhupada, how can we both be right? Yes, you are both right. Because in Ram's name there is Balram also. And in Balram's name there is Ram also. So you are both right. Isn't it? After all, when Gargamuni came to give the name to the two little children, Krishna and Balram, he said that he has all the Bala strength of Ram. And therefore, he will be called Balaram. Okay. So he, that Balaram has all the strength of Ram. Ram has 14 qualities, which are divine. They are called kalas actually, not qualities. Qualities, Ram has got 60. And Krishna has 64. But the kalas, 14 and 16. 16 is Krishna. Full. Purna Purushottam. Ram is Maryada Purushottam. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Udar Purushottam. Okay. There are three Purush Uttams. Purush means Purush. And Uttam means Supreme. Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is how the name Supreme Personality of Godhead comes. Purush Uttam. So, that's why when you read the Srimad Bhagavatam, purport, Prabhupada says, for Ram also Supreme Personality of Godhead. For Krishna also he says Supreme Personality of Godhead. For Balram also he says Supreme Personality of Godhead. So I used to wonder, who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead? Then it occurred to me that he is only translated in English, and just as we said, that there is only one word, love, but in Sanskrit there is prem also, which means absolute love for Krishna only. We, in the colloquial language, may say, ye ladka wo ladki ko prem karta hai. But that is not real prem. Actually, after a few years, we'll see what happens to that prem. Actually, they end up fighting only. So, because that can never be. Men will always be attracted to younger women. Whether you like it or not. That is the nature of man. You see, it's unfortunate or fortunate, I don't know. But that is how it is. But if that young man starts loving Krishna and Krishna's devotees and his books, his paraphernalia, and most important, his prasadam, of course, they all love, then that love changes to prem, to Krishna prem. Because you are not going to have any love in Golok Vrindavan. Golok Vrindavan, it's all prem, 100%. And because you wanted separation, prem, that separation prem from Krishna is called love, and that's why we unfortunately were born in this world. That is how we came to the material world. Because we wanted to separately enjoy from Krishna. We didn't want to offer everything to Krishna. Thoda mere liye bhi rakho. Some percentage. That is why Prabhupada once was given some, I don't want to give names because he is a very, very great friend and a very great man. It's from the Ford family. The name, you all know his name. So then, he went and gave Prabhupada a few $1,000,000. At that time, Prabhupada was happy even to get $5 or $10 or $100. But Prabhupada didn't react. He says that if he's such a big person, he's bound to give $1,000,000. For him, he's parting with some of it. So he asks a question, how much are you keeping back? Abhi toh maine $1,000,000 de diya. And you are asking me, how much are you keeping back? Use all of it in Krishna's service. That is what he told him. And that is why that huge, big, beautiful building is coming up in Mayapur. Okay. That is the question mark which Prabhupada had asked long, long back. And his conversation with Amrish Prabhuji. And that is how Amrish is building that beautiful, exquisite offering to Srila Prabhupada. Because Prabhupada wanted the whole capital of the world, spiritual capital of the world, I should say, to be at Mayapur. And that is a fact. Because the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself has said, and others also, that Mayapur is the place of worship. Vrindavan is his home. And Prabhupada added one more. And my office is Bombay. So Radharas Maharaj chose Bombay. Very intelligent. So, and good for us. Prabhupada added that. Up to that time, nobody said that Bombay is my office. You see, people were only talking of Vrindavan and Mayapur. But now, because this is Krishna's office, we are having the benefit of Gopinathji. You all know that these three, Madan Mohan, Govindji and Gopinath, they are the three great temples, deities of Vrindavan. The first one is Madan Mohan. What is Madan Mohan ji? Anybody knows? Huh? Gives you what? Relationship. Sambandha. Correct? And then Govindji gives you service. You see? Once you have a relationship, supposing a child is born. Okay, so the relationship is established. One is a child, one is a mother. Then the mother starts serving the child, right? By giving the child her own milk, cleaning him, washing him, etc., etc. And then there is prem. So Radha Gopinath are pure prem. So we are very, very fortunate that we have Radha Gopinath deities right here. So this Venu is giving us pure prem. Okay. So this whole chapter and what will follow after this chapter is not of this material world. We are now going to go in the spiritual world. You got the ticket, all of you. You are fortunate you are here. And if you keep coming here every day morning you are going to go further and further into this Krishna Leela of going home back to Godhead. Furthermore, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says very beautifully that I'll just read out if it's all right. What auspicious activities, Kushalam, did the Venu flute perform to become Krishna's wife? I didn't know that Venu was Krishna's wife. Of course, we know that there are 8 principal wives of Krishna, starting with Rukmini ji. There were also those 16,000 girls who were locked up and they became wives, 16,108. But Venu is also wife according to the gopis. It did not do anything auspicious because it took birth as a non-moving creature, a low birth resulting from a lack of piety. Yet that flute drinks nectar of Damodar's lips. How can we tolerate that? No, because we have the gopis, we have the first right to taste the nectar. After all, Krishna was born as a gopa and we were born as gopis. Therefore, we have the first right, and yet the flute has stolen our right. So they became jealous. Alright? And that is why we are jealous. Because we are perverted reflection of that jealousy. That jealousy is different. That is a spiritual jealousy. Where they want Krishna to benefit more. But here is a case where the flute has benefited more. Furthermore, the flute has audacity to manifest as a male in form and still enjoy Krishna to become his wife. So it was like confusing to the gopis. That how is it that the flute is born a male and has now become female? Actually, there are certain fishes actually in this world who are born male, then they become female, then they have children and they become male again. Actually, there are. So, having heard of that and seen that on, what is that? Geographical, something like that, no? Geographical, National Geographical. I saw it, I was shocked. Then I understood that Krishna can make a male a female and female a male. Actually, the truth is, every soul, jivatma in this room and everywhere in this universe is a female. That is the truth. It really hurts my ego to be called a female. But anyway, that is Krishna says that. We are supposed to serve Krishna. We are actually. But because of our the gunas of passion, then you get a male body more. Of course, most females here are ignorant. Ullu hai. That is, what is that thing called? Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Tamas. Isn't it? So, because we have these Tamas and Rajas guns, therefore we are born in these bodies. If we are pure Sattva, we go home back to Godhead. Unfortunately, I don't have much time. I was told to stop now. But if you want to go more in detail, please read these two books. Because they've got volumes of material in there about Venu Geet, about the gopis, how the gopis reacted, why the gopis married. They didn't marry, but their duplicates married other than Krishna. Actually, when Krishna took away their clothes, that is the moment when they really got married to Krishna in the river. You all know that story, no? Gopi Vastra Arana Leela. Then Purnamasi, she is the one who instigated them to leave in the middle of the night and escape. The word used is escape actually. And it was all made arrangement by Yogmaya. So this whole Venu Geet is a beautiful chapter and I'm sure you'll love to hear more about it. The next chapter is even better and I have already been told that I must continue. So I have to give one class more on this subject. Because this is the essence of Krishna consciousness. And it can only be heard or understood by those. You may be in the room, you'll hear, but it won't be understood by you unless you have understood the earlier part and become at least 90% Krishna conscious. Then you can become 100%. Hare Krishna. Is there any comments or any questions? Mataji, your phone.
Thank you very much, Srinathji Prabhu. You are a most learned, intelligent person.
And
I always ask you so many foolish questions which you answer me. At the moment, actually, I have two, if you have time. My first question is, you were saying that gopis are jealous of flute. So jealousy is existing in Golok Vrindavan also.
Spiritual jealousy.
Spiritual world.
Spiritual jealousy.
Spiritual jealousy. And you said everything which is here is a perverted reflection of above.
Urdhamula Madhasyakam, 15.1, Bhagavad Gita.
Yeah. So a very foolish thought came into my mind that if everything is a perverted reflection of the spiritual world, then what is this? This poverty, suffering, dukkh. Itna bhyankar chizya, so much horrible things are here in this world of what they are reflection of the spiritual world.
Second question. This is the first question.
Second, we say that we suffer according to our karmas, right? So when we are doing so much bhakti and all, we cannot get rid of our karmas. So how to get rid of your karma? They say, oh, you'll go to the next life, you'll be a better person, you'll be this and that. But what about this life?
Very good.
Thank you.
So let's take up your first question. You see, the topmost part of a tree that is mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, on the banks of the river, there is a big tree, then the topmost part of the tree becomes the lowest part in the reflection. So the maximum rich wealth, because after all Krishna has infinite wealth, and therefore in Dwarka, Leela, you find Krishna's palaces made of Chintamani. You see, they are not made of bricks and mortar and cement. So they are beautiful temples virtually for all the queens he equally made. And because he has these eight great siddhis, he is Yogeshwara. I was reading yesterday only the eight siddhis and 10 minor siddhis. The eight major siddhis like Anima, Manima, Mahamya, Prasita, Yasita and so on, Prapti, you can expand yourself. Some yogis do know how to do that. Prabhupada himself writes. So, the great wealth of Dwarka, riches, when it is misused by the Jivatma, then poverty comes at any time. Supposing you have some wealth, whatever, 100 rupees, but out of that you give 10 rupees or 15 rupees for feeding a cow or giving to prasadam or giving in this hundi box, whatever, then you are using part of that wealth properly. Then you get that reaction. You'll get in this material world. Okay? Because in this material world, action and reaction are equal and opposite. Okay? This is a law of physics. You can't change it. It's a law of God actually. So, these miseries which have come on all of us are actually not gifted by God. They are not the one. He doesn't want you to have miseries. But just like, at least in my school, I went to a school in the British time. It was called Cathedral High School. It's near Fort. Our principal was a Scotsman and he had a long soti. Soti means a cane. That is not allowed now. But everyone was afraid of that soti. Every boy. Because we were mischievous, no doubt. And then we would get 6 of the best. Means chetan. More mischief, then you get 12. Multiple. Okay. Small mistake, 1 only. That's minor. But that one, chamak, you know, you... there will be a line on your hand or in your back. So, because those days they used to say, spare the rod and spoil the child. You know, Victorian thought. Nowadays, you know, we have to pacify the child. We have to properly, you know, spoil him. Kya kya karna padta hai? We have virtually to bribe them. So, the thing is that God always punishes us, whether you like it or not. Small mistake, you know, a big man makes a small mistake, it gets in every newspaper, magazine, TV, everywhere. If a man on the street makes a small mistake, nobody bothers, you know. But the higher you go, either in your wealth or in your political position or whatever position, and you make, therefore when Mahatma Gandhi used to make a mistake, he said, I make mistakes. In fact, he wrote a whole book, Experiments on Truth. He used to use the word Himalayan mistake. You see, that was the wording he used. Because I'm not supposed to have made that mistake, still I've made that mistake. Now, who's going to correct me? Who will correct a so-called quote-unquote Mahatma Gandhi? You know? So, miseries will be there, Mataji. And the second part of your question, you think you are doing very good work. You think that I should not get suffering. After becoming Krishna conscious, so many people have left. Krishna conscious movement because of that thinking. I did so much for Prabhupada, I did so much for Krishna, and look what Krishna has done for me. But actually there is a mountain of past karmas we have done in 84 lakh unis. You see? So what happens? We have to clear all of this. You follow? So this clearing a mountain is not easy. Sometimes you want to climb a mountain also you can't climb. Forget about clearing it. You follow? We've got mountains of miseries waiting for us. But by chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, that mountain becomes like the footprint of a calf has water in it, no? You can jump across. Very easily. You can't jump across the mountain, but you can jump across that little water in the footprint of a calf. That's what the Bhagavatam says. And we've seen that tremendous difficulties and problems we've had, which nearly ruins us. Okay, never mind. But if we are Krishna conscious, we depend on Krishna, and we become humble, and whoever we thought was doing something bad for us, we go to him only. Go to them only. And sit with them. I'll tell you a story. I was going to build a factory at near Ankleshwar. Okay? With the Goodyear collaboration. Goodyear is a famous company in America. And that, one of the raw materials was, is there any chemical engineer here? Butadiene, styrene, and acrylonitrile nitride. Now, what does acrylonitrile do? Any idea? It is a harmful chemical. It can cause cancer. Okay. If it leaks out, means like, you know, you had in Bhopal that leakage and thousands of people died. This same thing could have happened. So I was thinking, saram, koi mar jayega, toh main bhi mar jaunga. He will die of acrylonitrile, I will be on my throat. So, what to do? So I asked these engineers and scientists in Goodyear, how to safeguard, you know, against leakage and all that. So they taught all the safety features and everything, as per American law. But then it occurred to me that why not I go to the sarpanch of the village next to me. And I went to his house. To my shock, I found that he was a Muslim. Theek hai, koi baat nahi. And so I told that sarpanch, ke main aapke wahan aata hun. And first thing, you know what they do in Gujarat? They give you a cup of tea and water. Sala, ye Muslim ka ghar mein hai. I have to drink his tea and I have to drink his water. But then what to do? I wanted some favor from him. I had to bow down to that level. Okay? And he says, you sit on my khatiya. So, charpai ke upar baithna padta hai. Full of all insects. I don't know what insects he had. Blood-sucking insects. Anyway, so there also you have to sit. And then I told him that this is a factory we are putting in all that. He said, har ek family mein se ek ladka lena padega aapko. Maine bola, le lenge. Chalo, kisi ko farming bane, gardening sikhayega, kisi ko watchman banayega, kuch karenge. Lekin I want you all to move 5 kilometers away from my factory. All of this land I want to buy and put trees. This is what the Indian government requires. So you'll have to fulfill that. You see? So then he said, then you want to buy all this property of ours. And I've got a darga here. You know, for Muslims, this is a, what do you call that? Somebody is buried there, some saint. What will you do with this? I said, why do you worry? The saint is dead already. He's not going to die again. You see, this is a place of your worship. I will worship it. No, why you worry? Am chadar rakhenge har roz. Chadar, you understand? Flowers. Flowers ka mattress. With that damn thing will cost how much? 20 rupees a day. So, that is cheaper. So, I calculated like a good Jew. You know, we are good Jews. Isme kya kharcha hone wala hai? Meet all the requirements. I had to do that. I had to. You see? And then I remembered Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saying that, or Haridas Thakur, he was a Muslim actually, after all. So what did I do, you know? I told him, you are so kind as to offer me tea and this. Will you take a little prasad from me? I had carried that prasad, you know. thinking that now I'm going to meet a Muslim, I'll have to have something from him. Action and reaction are equal and opposite. The action hua uska, mera reaction hua. Krishna is pleased with that. Okay. So if somebody hurts you, somebody gives you misery, give him prasad. Best thing on earth. Okay. Mataji, have I answered your question? Both of them? Any other questions or comments? Yes. Okay.
I have a specific question about Venu.
Yes.
As you said that Venu becomes male.
No, Venu is a male.
Is a male.
And becomes female.
There is so many words in Indian languages like Basri, Bansi and all. They are used as a feminine gender. And in grammatically speaking, in English, flute is used as a neuter gender. So, would you like to comment on this?
Yeah, thank you. This gentleman is blind, is it? Acha. So, first of all, the English language, unlike Latin and French, they don't have this gender system. For instance, we say that water, jal, pani, isn't it? So, actually speaking, it can become female gender, it can become male gender also. Okay? Because it is not having reproduction. But when there is a reproduction, then it is male or female. Okay? So, this flute, once it went to Krishna's lips, lotus lips, it had capacity to do both. It could, whatever Krishna wants, I am prepared. Venu is totally surrendered to Krishna. You have got very good ears, right? Huh? You can hear me well, right? Because God has gifted you with better ears than mine. Because once God takes away one indri, He gives you 10 times more capacity in the other indris. So please listen to this, that the Venu and all the others, like I told you, Bansri, Murli, then I told you, San Mohini, Aksharini, all of them are female actually. Because they are all serving Krishna. Female means serving Krishna. Okay. You and I are both in men's body, means we are having like a coat and pant, shirt and pant. Usually shirt pant is male clothing. Nowadays we see women also wearing shirt pant. That's a different story. They go to the office, so therefore they wear that. So, that is, but when the shirt pant comes out, we know what happens. So then, Venu is actually originally from the bamboo. Alright. And it is low born according to the gopis. Because it is not from even an animal kingdom. Not even from a human kingdom. From a tree kingdom. Yet because it comes in contact with Krishna's lotus lips. Okay. Krishna has accepted Venu as a female. Alright? Now, who are we to object to that? Why should we tell Krishna why you did this or that? It's up to His mercy. He likes. He enjoys. Let Him do what He wants. And whether we like or not, He'll do what He wants. He will do exactly what He wants. Because He is Purna Purushottam. He is supreme. Okay? So one should not get too much involved in technicalities. Just accept what the authorities like Jiva Goswami and Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur has said. Because it struck me as really strange. But then I saw that even a fish can change from male to female and female to male. I was surprised. And there was no doctor, huh? No sexologist. Fish. There was on its own were doing that. So how this was happening? Okay. You follow? You should actually pray that you want to play the Venu. Oh. So, you will be able to play the Venu? Okay. You play any instrument? Yes, you can play. You can play the tape recorder. It's after all an instrument. You can play some musical instrument. Okay. You may not play with your mouth or with your hands. Okay. So you get some tapes or something, CDs from our tape ministry and use that. And sing gloriously. Because blind people usually can sing better than those with eyes. It's very strange, but that's how it is. Okay. Hari Bol, thank you for your question. I think we'll stop here. Hare Krishna.